All right, good morning. Sorry for the few minutes delay in getting started. My name is Talia Dubovi. I'm the Deputy Director of the Global Health Policy Center here at CSIS. It is my pleasure to welcome you this morning to what promises to be an engaging conversation marking the Lancet's publication of a new series on faith-based healthcare. Before we get started, I want to thank Shepard and Anita Smith for all of their work on this morning's event. I also want to say a thank you to Katie Peck and Jillian Locke on my team who were instrumental in pulling everything together this morning. Faith is a powerful force in the lives of individuals and communities throughout the world. Faith-based organizations are an important provider of healthcare globally, and they are a resource for improving access to health services and support, particularly at the community level and for hard-to-reach populations in some of the poorest places in the world. As Rick Warren of Saddleback Church has noted, there may not be a health facility in every town, village, and hamlet throughout the world, but there usually is a church or a mosque or another place of worship. Engaging and leveraging the reach of faith leaders can be critical to meeting global health and development goals. The nexus between faith and health and the potential for better cooperation and new partnerships is an important topic for us here at CSIS. We've explored these issues through a variety of lenses, including active collaboration with the faith community around the AIDS 2012 conference here in DC, as well as through Janet Fleischman's work looking at opportunities for faith leaders to play a role in promoting knowledge of and access to family planning and reproductive health services. These issues will continue to be a focus of our work. As we celebrate the role faith-based healthcare can play in the global health arena, we must also acknowledge the challenges and disagreements that are sometimes associated with the faith community's role, notably in discouraging or opposing the use of basic health services, including family planning and immunization, as well as controversies in places like Uganda, where discrimination against the LGBT community endangered people living with HIV. Moving forward, it will be critical to find ways to engage productively on these sensitive issues. It is also essential to better understand the role and contributions of faith-based providers and to improve coordinations between the faith and health communities. We will hear more about all of these important topics from our panelists today. I will now turn the microphone over to Bill Summerskill, Senior Executive Editor at The Lancet, who will introduce our first panel.
Thank you, and good morning. On behalf of the authors, I'm delighted to introduce this session about the Lancet series on faith-based healthcare. This was made possible by a sponsorship from Capital for Good. In addition to the booklets that you've received, additional material is available online for free, and the full contents will be published in the weekly edition of The Lancet next month. Faith-based organizations deliver a substantial amount of healthcare around the world. How much and to what benefit has not been well documented. In preparation for the Sustainable Development Goals, in which collaboration between different sectors will be crucial, this series sets out to estimate the contribution of faith-based organizations to healthcare, the particular strengths and weaknesses of faith-based actors, and how their expertise might be best recruited in the future. By doing so, the authors have initiated a respectful, science-based dialogue about faith-inspired behaviors, to which we welcome the input of CSIS. The three panelists here were each lead authors on one of the three review papers in the series. Going from your left to right, Jill Olivier has worked with the World Bank and is now senior lecturer and research coordinator at the University of Cape Town. She is also director of the International Religious Health Assets Program. Jill combines these skills as the lead author of paper one, Understanding Roles of Faith-Based Healthcare Providers in Africa. Andrew Tompkins is Emeritus Professor of International Child Health at University College London. He combines a distinguished academic career with extensive experience in the field to present a sensitive review about the influence of religious beliefs on behavior in the second paper, Controversies in Faith and Health. The final review, towards stronger partnerships between public sector and faith groups for improved health was not intended as such, but rather planned as a brief viewpoint. However, peer reviewers were so enthusiastic that the authors were asked to expand the manuscript into a full-length review. Leading that effort was Jean Duff, head of the Partnership for Faith and Development and coordinator of the Joint Learning Initiative on Faith and Local Communities. And at your far right, Anita Smith will moderate today's session. She is president of the Children's AIDS Fund and a past co-chair of the President's Advisory Council on HIV/AIDS. Ladies and gentlemen, the panel.
Thank you. Thank you so much to CSIS for hosting this important event and to Bill for the introduction. I did want to ask Bill one question, if I could, before we start with the panelists. You probably would need to get back to the microphone. But this entire series would not be possible without all of your support. And I just wanted to hear from you as we start this discussion, what your goals are in terms of how you want to see the material that's being published used and how you'd like to see outcomes based on what you're supporting through this effort.
Thank you, Anita. The founder of the Lancet in 1823 set out with two purposes, to inform and to reform. And so the name Lancet means both a surgical instrument and a narrow window. And Thomas Wackley said, I want to use it for both these purposes, to cut out bad practice and to shine light on good practice. And I think that still directs the way we approach topics. And health is such a vast part of our lives with so many different interfaces that this is a really large area of health which has received disproportionate attention over the years. It's a very sensitive area, and I think that may have made it difficult for groups to explore it in the past. And I think it's also a very vast area with a heterogeneous evidence base. So it's difficult to make firm conclusions in the way one might do for other aspects of healthcare. So with this issue, what we want to do, however imperfect, is to set down a marker and to say, this is an important topic. It's going to actually be more important in the future, and if we are to achieve the Sustainable Development Goals, we need the help of all potential actors. What I'm hoping is that this initiates a dialogue which is then taken up by other science, sociology, health journals, that we move the influence of faith-based provision of healthcare from the margins of the debate and make it mainstream. So my metric of success would be for people to write in 3, 4, 5 years' time, this was great, but it's so terribly out of date, this issue. I'd like to see things move on. And as they do move on, I hope that the Lancet can be part of that.
Great. Thank you so much for that perspective, which gives us a perfect foundation for the presenters this morning. Jill?
Thank you. Good morning, everybody. I'm going to crane my neck a little bit because I do have a few slides. This paper that I'm presenting on behalf of my co-authors, if, for those of you that are not familiar with the area at the intersection between religion and public health and development, it's a very diverse area with major evidence holes. I don't even say gaps. They are big black holes where we simply do not know things like how many faith-based providers, services there are, what is the influences of faith on individual health behaviors. So what this paper sought to do was to provide a synthesis based on a series of systematic reviews on which the authors were a part, a synthesis of primary research in which there was some substantial evidence that could actually be that could be committed to. So what the focus ended up being on was on African faith-based health service providers. We were presenting this at the bank, and I thought I'd put this quote up there, but there's been a lot of these kinds of quotes that have been floating around for the last 20 years. There's this idea that there's a substantial provision of health service provision in Africa by these faith-based health providers, but the sense that we don't really know the numbers, we don't really know what's going on. These kinds of quotes have been around for a long time, but I think I would argue that we do know a little bit more now in the recent time. So what this paper is focusing on is specifically on that cluster of countries in Africa where there is a particular presence of faith-based biomedical health service providers. So we're not looking at traditional healing practices here. We're not looking at faith healing. We're not looking at a variety of other important issues. This is really looking at the hospitals, the clinics, the primary healthcare centers in those regions. The evidence base is biased towards Africa, towards Christianity, and towards English literature. I'm saying that now. We did not know enough about the Islamic facilities and the other facilities. We did not know about the Northern Africa, Sahel regions. But there is some evidence in relation to those countries. This is a very common slide. The first column provides the national faith-based health networks self-declare on their percentage of health service providers against the public service provider. So, for example, they normally count it on number of hospital beds or number of facilities, and they would compare the faith-based Christian, normally the Christian faith-based health services, against the government facilities. I must just point out these figures are highly contentious. I wouldn't like to get a quotation in the New York or whatever Washington News saying I've quoted these. What the paper tries to unpack is the fact that these figures are very contentious. And what we actually argue is that there's a need to move away from this focus on percentages of market share. The argument is that basing your entire engagement on the faith sector on the idea of whether or not they provide 20 or 25 or 30% of the health services is actually less important than the issues such as, do they provide quality health care to the rural poor? Do they emphasize universal health coverage to people that don't otherwise get access? Do they provide a different kind of care that supports the system and makes the general national health system more resilient? And so really the argument is to say, moving away from those kinds of figures of market share and trying to look at things such as utilization, cost, satisfaction. And so we're pulling on data in this paper. We were trying to pull on what data there is on these other aspects which we consider to be more important. I'll just touch on a couple of issues. We presented some household survey data, which was looking at utilization, which did show some slightly lower market share than we had originally assumed. However, it's comparing apples and oranges to the bed-based kind of comparison, so don't worry about that too much. But we did find quite a lot of evidence to the fact that a lot of in those countries, a lot of patients were reporting on higher satisfaction levels. And those higher satisfaction levels were normally based on the idea that they were getting a higher quality of service in the faith-based versus the public facilities. There was also some evidence to show that faith-based health service provision is particularly important in weak health systems, and that's not just in Africa, but that's internationally. And weak health systems is not just normally weak health systems, but also in times of humanitarian crisis, in emergency response. That is when faith-based health services jump in. I'm not going to go through this whole slide, but just to say that there is, as I mentioned earlier, there's a push towards away from broad generalizations about faith-based health service providers. I would encourage you very strongly not to use the word FBO just generically. There are all kinds of FBOs and FB things, and so really, so being specific in the evidence, being specific in the engagement, and being specific in implementation strategies is really important. And I'm going to stop there.
Thank you very much, Jill. So we'll go ahead and have all the presentations and then open for questions. So, Andrew?
Well, we had a very interesting and challenging task of looking at the controversies. And as you would imagine from the title, we had a rich diversity of people to inquire and include in the team. And I think the key thing we wanted to emphasize in the paper was that there are many, many people who report faith in the world. In fact, the Pew Forum actually says that in their surveys, more than 84% of the world's population report having a faith. So this slide just shows some of the major faiths, and our methodology involved looking at differences between faiths and sometimes differences within faiths. And that is a very important thing to do. The second slide, I think, just shows the importance of not being too simplistic in attributing anything to faith belief alone. This slide just emphasizes that in the center, we're talking about things like attitudes and beliefs and prejudices and behavior and choice of technologies, all the things that we think of every day. But it isn't just faith that actually influences. Sometimes it's actually centuries and thousands of years of culture. Sometimes it's our social and economic aspects. Sometimes it's issues in relation to the laws in the country, which may actually conflict with faith. And obviously, there are very important political dimensions. And unfortunately, sometimes beliefs and behaviors are affected by extremist ideological positions. When we looked at various components, we looked, as you will see in the paper, at a series of health-damaging behaviors, which included childhood marriage, opposition to immunization, violence against women, and female genital mutilation. And we looked at the way that faiths actually had a viewpoint on this. And then we looked at how, notwithstanding the considerable varieties, there was often a commonality. And we gave a lot of examples in the paper of ways in which groups, sometimes with different faith backgrounds, have come to work together for the reduction of child marriage, for the increase in uptake of immunization, for the improvement of care for women, for the reduction of stigma and improvement in the provision and care in HIV/AIDS. So those were some of the things that we looked at. And this slide just shows a bit of a problem. What we found was that within the faith leadership group, there was often a limited awareness of what was going on in the world. And we actually found that there was a considerable problem in faith leaders remaining within their intellectual and theological faith faculties. At the same time, we found that those working in some development agencies and some working in some development agencies were actually extremely unaware of what faith actually meant. And therefore, there was a tendency, particularly for those affected by intense secular agendas, to stay within their secular silos. So we had faith faculties and secular silos. Now, this may be a bit of a parody, and I do apologize to those of you who object to this, but we actually specifically raise it. But because we saw at the bottom some remarkable opportunities of faith groups, you're probably using the word that actually I've just been told not to use, but faith groups working intensively with governments and local communities. And we provide within the paper some great examples of that. What are our recommendations? Well, we would like to see that the healthcare leaders become more faith active and the faith leaders become more health active. I'm not suggesting that all faith leaders join gyms, or health leaders go to the mosque. But it's obviously important that literacy and understanding are improved. Notwithstanding these issues, we do provide some evidence, and there's quite a lot of peer-reviewed evidence showing that there is remarkable opportunity for faith to be integrated within programs. And we can actually see that already there are opportunities for imaginative program. So what do we seek to achieve from this paper? We would hope discussion, possibly disagreement, but we see actually quite likely to be an opportunity for groups to work together for the improvement of care. And what our real goal is to move from controversies into compassionate, professional, patient-sensitive, faith-sensitive care, especially for the hard to reach. And we do not believe that the goals of sustainable development will be achieved unless some of the issues that we raise in our paper are taken into action. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew.
Thank you so much, Anita. Juggle my side. Good morning, everyone. Thanks to CSIS and to Shepherd and Anita for helping to organize this session. Thank you, Bill and the Lancet. Thank you, my fellow authors and the working group of amazing people who collaborated over a sustained period of time to bring this unprecedented series on faith-based healthcare to launch at a conference on religion and sustainable development, which was held over the last several days at the World Bank. Kay Warren was a key inspiration to this series, informed by her deep lived-out experience, personal experience, of how religious and faith-based organizations transform stigma and save lives of people living with HIV/AIDS. Our paper picks up really where Andrew just left off. It focuses on the question of partnership between public sector organizations, between governments and donors, and faith groups in general, and the question of what exists by way of partnership and what might scale up and strengthen partnerships. The paper lays out a case that the time is now right in the context of development trends and opportunities to very substantially increase engagement with faith-based organizations. It basically posits the notion that policy and policymakers seems to be moving beyond the question now of whether to engage, but how to collaborate. The paper offers a couple of signs, including the recent meeting between President Kim at the World Bank and the Holy Father, where they discussed their mutual approach to implementing a preferential option for the poor. At our conference over the last couple of days, a notion that was tagged in the paper of public sector organizations themselves becoming more activist around these issues was underscored by the very activist participation of the German government, who have newly constituted a focus within their development agency on this work. On the faith side, groups, next slide please, sorry, Anita. Great, thank you. And now the next slide. On the faith side, the paper reviews how existing partnerships and mechanisms are expanding collaboration. And we look at those in three groups. We look at large-scale interventions, such as the Australian government's extraordinary 10-year investment in Papua New Guinea, where they work through the congregational networks of seven denominations to provide services to the very poor there. We look at public co-funding for faith-based hospital and primary care through national networks, such as the church's health associations throughout Africa. And thirdly, we look at global health campaigns where faith groups are involved, such as the United Methodists' Imagine No Malaria campaign, which to date has raised over $66 million and is a significant donor to the Global Fund for AIDS, TB, and Malaria. So a very interesting partnership there between a faith body and a multilateral donor organization. The paper also references the long-standing ongoing efforts at key UN agencies to facilitate partnerships. I would like to just note, in terms of the co-funding, the important leveraging by public sector of private, substantial private assets that the faith community brings to the work of development. And to tag for your further reading a study of the revenues of US faith-based NGOs, which in 2013 amounted to over $6 billion, of which public funding represented only a small proportion. I think it was $777 million, so a small share. Next slide, please. The paper reviews, the paper drills down on the case for partnership by looking more specifically at contributions to the prevention of maternal and child deaths, and unpacks the Every Woman, Every Child framing by UNICEF that looks at the accelerator behaviors that are key to determining health outcomes for women and children, and makes the point in a systematic way that faith communities are very well positioned to influence those key health-related attitudes and behaviors, such as breastfeeding, immunization, access to care, that make a difference to those health outcomes. We offer a variety of interesting case studies and examples from Nigeria, from Mozambique, from Sierra Leone and DRC and elsewhere, and I commend them to your more detailed attention. Finally, the paper drills down on a series of recommendations for strengthening partnerships, and those recommendations are clustered in five areas. And again, time doesn't permit us to go into them, but we offer them for your further consideration. They include a suggestion of new business models, in a sense, ways in which both the development communities and the faith groups can reorganize themselves and strengthen themselves to be more effective in partnership mechanisms. It was interesting that when this paper was conceived almost 18 months ago, the conference that took place over the last couple of days was not even intended. But it was absolutely fascinating, I think, for all of us to see how the work embodied in the Lancet paper was very much a grounding for the conference over the last couple of days. And these recommendations that you see here were elaborated very extensively in the work of the conference, which looked at ways to strengthen partnerships between public sector and faith-based organizations. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Jean. Well, based on these presentations, this is just a taste of what is in the document that you have that you will definitely want to read if you aren't already into it. Thank you all for your excellent presentations. Just wanted to, while you're preparing your questions in the audience, let me just ask each of you a question. Jill, wanted to clarify that the faith is hospitals that you were looking at. Were you looking at clinics or just hospitals? How extensive was the data?
The data was looking at all levels of health facilities down to primary care level. But again, there are data holes all over the place. But most of those ones that were shown there are Christian health associations, and they normally map the whole number of facilities down to primary care level.
Okay. And I mean, there obviously is a lot of work to be still done to get beyond just the Christian facilities. Is there work underway that you're aware of?
There's work underway, but there's also, I just want to stress, there's a lot of complexity as well. There are a lot of, for example, health facilities, faith-based facilities that are owned by the church, but that operate as a public district hospital, for example. So it's not quite as black and white and clear cut, but yes, there is work underway in a number of countries worldwide, really, too.
And how many of those facilities would be kind of a partnership between government and faith?
It differs per country. They call them district designated hospitals, and there's probably 20 or so big hospitals. They're normally in areas where there is not a substantial presence of the public system yet.
Okay, great. Thank you. Andrew, what an interesting paper, and look at the controversies. How did you and your team go about deciding kind of what you were going to look at,
and how did the team work together to come up with the outcomes in the paper?
With fear, trepidation, energy, enthusiasm, and an objectivity. I'm just giving those off the top of my head. Basically, as scientists, we are basically looking at what is the evidence. And we didn't have any particular axe to grind. And as the readers of the paper will see, there were representatives for looking at all the major faiths in the issues. We came particularly from the perspective of what are the particular needs for hard-to-reach populations, of particularly women and children in poor communities, unreached communities in poor countries. And that was really why we looked at some of the key risk factors for poor mortality rates, poor nutrition rates, and poor development of children and adults. How we did it, we basically looked at the problems, and we analyzed them using traditional sacred texts, and we also looked at the ways those texts have been interpreted in different ways. And then we moved on to see how the texts have actually inspired and driven health workers to provide services in very difficult situations.
Mm. Very interesting. Thank you. Jean, congratulations on already putting some legs to this effort through the conference. And I know it was a very successful event. And I think one of the questions that people have is why have these partnerships been so difficult to bring about, and why has it taken this long to come to this place?
Thanks, Anita. The event that Anita is referring to is this conference on religion and sustainable development, effective partnerships to end extreme poverty, which was held over the last couple of days at the World Bank and co-hosted by the US government, I'm looking at Mark Brinkmiller here in the front row, the German government, the British government, World Vision, and other leading faith-based organizations. In itself, I think it represents part of the answer to the question. I mean, an extraordinary collaboration among governments, faith-based organizations, and the academic community around these issues. Anita, I think that part of what we struggle with is a cultural divide. We have different methods and different approaches. We definitely have a common ground, and certainly as framed now by the coming Sustainable Development Goals and this commitment to end extreme poverty, we have very clearly common grounds, but we have different approaches. And I think what's so heartening about the discussions over the last couple of days was the spirit of collaboration, the reciprocal frame. Yes, a call for, on the part of the public sector organizations, for a very strong evidence grounding and really a challenge to the faith community to step up just the kinds of evidence that Jill and her team, for example, have been presenting as a basis for discussion. But I think that our work, the work ahead, continues to be the building of trust, the building of understanding, the building of what we call faith literacy and development literacy across the two communities. And I would like to just point out that the materials, all the materials for the conference, are available on the website of the Joint Learning Initiative at www.jliflc.com. And I commend those to you.
Great. Thank you. Great. Thank you. Well, now we'll open the floor to questions. There'll be people coming by with microphones, and so please wait to get the microphone before you ask your question. I'd like you to identify yourself and your organization before you ask a question. We'll take three at a time, and then we'll pose them to the panel. Okay, we've got several hands up here.
Good morning. Ladies and gentlemen, Thank you so much for your presentation. My name is Rosemary Seguero. I'm an organization called Hope for Tomorrow, a USA-based organization, though we are also based in Kenya. Thank you so much for your presentation. I just wanted to mention about what he said on there has not been partnership, collaboration, outreach, and awareness through partnership with civil society, government, and other people. So how do we make this happen? Like HIV failed because of lack of coordination, collaboration. Like I'm here, civil society, what we are talking here, people in Africa don't know what we are talking about. So this message is very, very important to faith-based all over the world, because without this message reaching them, there can't be any implementation. So how do we work with you guys? We just came up with applications of communication where people in Africa can hear what we are talking now, using healthcare, education, and everything. So how do we collaborate instead of just hearing of the report, instead of actual implementation and results of what you are talking? Thank you.
Hi, my name is Katie Lutens, and I'm the health program coordinator at the Corporate Council on Africa, which is an association of businesses interested in Africa. This question is mostly, I think, for Andrew. Did you find big differences between religions, particularly religions that do not have sacred texts or that don't have one overarching philosophy for the entire religion, like folk, you know, Vodun folk-based religions?
Thank you.
My name is Michael Azefor. I'm a retired World Bank staff. I have worked in many countries in sub-Saharan Africa, and for more than 35 years. And a lot of what is discussed here is timid, in the sense that I expected your team to look at the relationship between faith-based health services and government policy development. The relationship between funding agencies and faith-based institutions in countries. I give examples to give a little clarity to my question. When I worked for the World Bank and went on missions to countries, my colleagues were very reluctant for us to spend time discussing either with the Baptists or the Catholics or the Presbyterian institutions. They were very unprepared to integrate statistical data from these facilities. I remember the case of the DRC, where at one time the Catholic Church was doing a lot more than the government was doing, but this was never really integrated in the analysis for policy reforms or for program development or for program evaluation. When I myself worked for the Cameroon government before I joined the World Bank, I helped and developed a relationship between the missionaries and the government, especially in the area of medical statistics. And the most complete statistics we were collecting were from the Reverend Sisters, the nuns, and so on and so forth, not from the government. I worked on other countries where when you visit a health center in an urban environment that is missionary run or faith-based run, attendance is probably four times the size of a more equipped, more staffed public health institution in the same town. There are several African countries where the referral hospital in the country is not in the capital city. It is in some remote little town managed either by the Catholics or by the Baptists. And so there's been a conflicting relationship. I hate to see us move ahead as if things have been very sweet and nice between government, policymakers, and development institutions, because it has not been the case. In fact, in some countries, the missionaries started training health personnel, but the governments got discouraged from supporting the programs because of World Bank, IMF institutions discouraging the use of public funds in what was classified as private enterprises.
Thank you.
And that has cost us a lot.
Okay, thank you for your observation. Let's take one more question, and then we'll go to the panel. Yes.
Good morning. My name is John Blevins. I'm director of the Interfaith Health Program at Emory University in the Rollins School of Public Health. My question is mainly to Dr. Tompkins, but wonder if others have thoughts on it as well. In regard to reaching hard-to-reach and vulnerable populations, particularly in activities and programs that might be of a contentious nature in cultural context, a lot of faith-based organizations that we're aware of that do that work arises intrinsically around a complicated but potentially contentious negotiation between the faith-based providers that do that work and their larger religious traditions. One of our concerns is that when actors from civil society or the multilateral or bilateral donors are made aware of those programs, how does it change the impact and the effect of those programs in ways that may be negative? That it makes them and the staff in those organizations more suspect, or the work of those organizations suspect, or maybe even puts those staff members and the people who receive services in danger. And I wonder if you saw any evidence of that, and if you have any thoughts about ways that civil society organizations and the large donors can be aware of how to build respectful partnerships with those organizations reaching hard to reach and vulnerable communities.
Thank you. Andrew, do you want to go ahead and respond to that?
Yeah, those were some great questions. Thank you. Thank you so much. If I could start with the core, which is coming out of nearly all of the questions, about collaboration. If we look at the political framework in which my comments are based, it is that sustainable development goals are going to talk about universal health coverage. That's a big challenge, but it's important. It's vital if we are to reduce poverty. The bank has changed its mind. It used to be saying you can only become healthy once you become rich. Now we're saying, and I know this is true, that the bank is saying that you have to be healthy to increase your standard of living. So the question, several things. Part of them are comments that have come out of our review in the paper and my authorship team, and partly are some comments because I've lived in Africa for many years and have been privileged to do so. The first thing is that when the faith groups are involved in healthcare delivery, it seems to me that often there is a tokenism rather than a true involvement. And one of the challenges seems to be the coming out of this, that the governments and the agencies actually need to lose the nervousness that you, sir, described, the anxiety, and just get real and say, if we want to achieve health coverage, then we have to look at ways of working together with partners who are working in the poorest. Now, that actually means that literacy, as Jean was saying, needs to be developed. And there are some good examples in the paper of ways in which faith leaders have actually been the leadership of the programs, particularly in some of the health damaging practices. And more recently, our experience in northeastern Nigeria is that the faith leaders are absolutely vital in assisting the increase in development of immunization services, which have tragically declined over the last few years. You mentioned, ma'am, about Kenya, and you give a good example of countries where there are great opportunities for people in government and the donors and the people who work at delivering healthcare to actually understand each other's language. And I think there needs to be a greater appreciation, a knowledge, and respect. And at the moment, I sometimes, to be quite blunt, have found that lacking in international development agencies. They do not want to accept that there are people who they disagree with in their own personal lives. So I think the challenge is, how do we get people to move out of their personal prejudices and work into global care, which is what we're talking about? Just a sort of a short answer.
Either of you would like to comment?
Should I? Sorry, I didn't catch your name. The gentleman from the World Bank. Mike, thank you. I think there's been a bit of a change since the era that you're talking about. I've been involved in this work for a long time, like a number of friends and colleagues have been as well. And in the beginning, even 15, 20 years ago, every time we started a meeting or every time we started writing something, the first sentence would have to make an argument for the relevance of even looking at this. It would have to make a statement about the relevance of even thinking about the collaboration with the faith community. And that's actually where those market share figures started coming out of, was because that was our one piece of evidence that people were using for that statement. But things have changed quite a bit. There is work on, and published work on, statistics on contracting. The WHO has sponsored work right now on the contracting relationship and the financial compensation relationship in three African countries, universal healthcare coverage studies. I'm not saying the relationships are not fraught, and I'm not saying that there is constant work to try and build the trust between the faith-based providers and the governments. It's an ongoing. All partnerships have dynamics. But I don't think it's quite the same as this kind of, no, we're not even going to think about it. I think there has been a change. There are lingering biases, secular biases, which many of you in DC will be very familiar with, and us as authors are very, very, very familiar with. And I think that was part of the what Bill was alluding to about saying how this is an unusual area of engagement for the Lancet because of those biases. But I think there's at an international level, I think there's a slight more openness to thinking about this and engaging this and considering those issues. And I just wanted to, I think the issue about Kenya and engagement, I think underlying your question was this, you know, why have the meeting in DC and talk about these things here rather than in the countries? I'm not sure if that was the underlying. All I can say is these conversations and these collaborative partnerships are absolutely happening on the ground in countries. Several partners here, USAID, PEPFAR, John Blevins from Emory, I know they're doing lots of work on collaboration and networking in Kenya with local partners. And so I think it's not just here in DC that these conversations are happening, if that was the subtext to your comment.
And just to support what my fellow authors are saying here, and going to our sister from Kenya's question around the challenges of partnership, what I'm so excited about is that there seems to be a real movement, both on the policy side and on the faith side, to look at evidence-based developments and new approaches to forging those partnerships. I see Deb Derrick in the audience there from Friends of the Global Fight on HIV/AIDS, TB. Organizations like the Global Fund, for example, are working now very, very intentionally on the challenge of how to engage more effectively and more inclusively local faith communities and faith-based partners in country. And indeed, I was so heartened during our conference to hear Christopher Benn from the Global Fund saying that during the Ebola situation in West Africa, that they directed their grantees to basically repurpose funds that had been assigned for HIV or TB to Ebola. I thought that was a wonderful example of sort of the institutional flexibility, obviously in a crisis, but a really, really good example of that. Going to Jill's point in terms of contracting and new innovative financing mechanisms and contracting, Kamarogo from your country, from Kenya, spoke to us at the conference yesterday and actually challenged faith-based healthcare delivery systems to formalize and to strengthen their contracting mechanisms. And in fact, he kind of challenged them to say that those MOUs that you have are not worth the paper that they're written on, and really pushing people towards more formal contracting. And then on the faith side, I think it's really up to us to step up, to offer a more robust collective organizations that bring us together in larger scale so that we can deal as collective bodies, not necessarily just small institutions, with governments so that they can achieve their scalable objectives in terms of development. Those are some thoughts.
Thank you. And Andrew, there was one more question for you on the differences between religions that you saw.
Yes, that was an interesting question. You asked about were there any differences between those who had a written theology as opposed to a more verbal. What was that? Yeah. The main faiths that we looked at obviously did have a written theology. What we didn't look at was, and we've actually referred to this in the paper, was the enormous richness of traditional faiths. And certainly, I can speak mainly in Africa, but I mean, I'm sure the truth is in Asia, where these faiths have been there for years, and are sometimes, in a syncretistic way, actually sort of combined with more modern faiths, such as Christianity and Islam. We didn't look at those because the diversity of those would have needed a lot more work. All we could see was a very interesting thing, is that there was a considerable enthusiasm among all the faith leaders for seeing how they could be more involved. And actually, there was a great opportunity expressed in the work that we did for making faith leaders more aware so that their sacred teachings, their preachings about traditional values could actually have a very clear health content, and they could be part of the action rather than just leaving everything to the health professionals. I don't know if that answers the question at all, but that's how we saw it.
Thank you. We're closing in on the end of the hour, unfortunately. Maybe we have time for two more questions and short answers from the panel. Any other questions? Okay. Well, I will ask each of you on the panel. You've done such an amazing work and, you know, have given us so much to think about. I would like to hear from you, kind of in summary, what you would like to see as next steps as a result of your work, that you've put so much effort into the research and the writing, and not necessarily related to the piece you've written, but how you'd like to see this play out. So, Jill?
I'll answer as an academic and someone immersed in information and evidence. That's where my head is at the moment. And it's very similar to the comment about the Lancet, by having these papers in here, signaling something in terms of the broader discipline. And I'll give you an example. We hosted a conference on the Health Systems Global Conference last year in Cape Town, 4,000 people there. I think there were two presentations that had anything to do with faith-based health providers of a big, massive, multi you know, thousands of people at this conference. And that's a signal to the fact that these issues come up in conferences. We have separate conversations about issues of faith and faith-based health providers, but they very rarely are integrated into the broader general public health development agendas and conversations. And so my hope would be that this, rather than this becoming a standalone conversation, actually gets more strongly integrated into the broader public health and development conversations.
Great. Andrew?
Yeah, I see this series and the amazing meeting that has just been on religion and sustainable development being a start of a place in which things can have markers. Now, I'm just a boring academic, but I do get enthusiastic from time to time. And the markers should be aimed at donors and health providers in terms of how aware are you, how much are you being inclusive, because many have been exclusive. We've got some wonderful examples that Jill's talking about that are in the paper. How inclusive are you of faith groups within your policies and your programs? And it will be possible to look at policy and to look at the international development agencies and to see how well they're coping with the challenges that this paper puts forward. Similarly, I would see that the faith groups have, they've made some wonderful responses in the last 10, 20 years, particularly in the area of HIV care, but there are many other examples. But how do the faith leaders actually become more aware of how their teachings can actually interface most profitably in association to build these partnerships up? And they too, I don't think they've ever been subject to peer review and monitoring and evaluation, but the peer review process would be a very interesting one with the faith leaders, the theological colleges, all the colleges that are churning out faith leaders. It would be very interesting to see if they could become more faith aware, because that does have enormous potential for changing the societies which are hurting at the present time.
One of our presenters at the conference yesterday, David Sutherland, who's working in the Philippines with an organization called International Care Ministry, challenged the conference with the notion of how do you measure hope and dignity? I think that our challenge now, and our real opportunity now, is to build on the growing interest by virtue of the scale of the ambition of the goals, the development goals, the growing interest on the part of policymakers for engaging all hands in the development task, and therefore also being very open, I think, to engaging faith-based assets. Our opportunity now is to pull together the evidence frame that shows to them that our work and our contribution will help achieve and help drive development outcomes and health outcomes. And I think that we need to do that in creative ways. A lot of the evidence already exists, and I think that we need to underscore and get much more creative at communication. And in the end of the day, I think that a lot of our work going forward is about building friendship and trust that will allow us to cross those cultural divides that we addressed earlier in the remarks in the paper.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you all. And again, thank you to the Lancet, Bill, for publishing this important series and opening the discussion, which will go on. Thank you very much.
We're now going to move very quickly to our second panel, which is going to look specifically at what all of this means for U.S. policy. For those of you who are standing in the back, there's a bunch of empty seats up here in the front. Please feel free to come on down and take a seat before this next panel gets started. Thanks.
We'll need you to turn on your microphone. Let's see. Okay, thank you, Tim. Thank you all. We, in the interest of time, we're going to dive right into the second panel. Which is going to give us an opportunity to look at the U.S. angle and the U.S. engagement with faith-based organizations and the genesis of those strategies and what impact and evolution we can see. And we are honored today to be joined by three very respected panelists. We have Sandy Thurman to my left, who is the Chief Strategy Officer for the Office of the Global AIDS Coordinator, and many of you know Sandy from her long work in this arena. In the middle, we have Mark Brinkmuller, who is the Director of the Center for Faith-Based and Community Initiatives at USAID, and on the far end, we have Jen Cates, who is the Vice President and Director of Global Health and HIV Policy at the Kaiser Family Foundation. You have their full bios in the handout, so I won't go into all the details, but you can see that we have a very illustrious, very, very important panel up here, and we are eager to dive into some interesting discussion on this. I think we all know, and the first panel made very clear, the importance of engaging with and understanding the role of the faith-based communities in providing global health, in providing information, especially in reaching communities, the poorest of the poor, hard to reach areas. I'm reminded of a time not long ago when I was in Ethiopia and interviewing a Orthodox priest and we were talking about family planning, and I asked him what message he gave to his followers. And he said, roughly translated, family planning isn't a sin. Hungry children is a sin. And it's just a fascinating lens through which we can see, again, the importance of faith leaders and the information they can transfer to their communities and the importance of engaging them and ensuring that they have the information and the capacity that's necessary to reach their communities with appropriate and accurate information. We have been engaging in some very interesting conversations on this subject, most recently last week with some faith providers from Kenya on the subject of family planning. So I think it's true what the first panel really emphasized, that things are evolving, things are developing, and this is an important moment to be exploring this further. And with this panel, we're very eager to talk about it from the focus of the US policy perspective. And I think to begin with, we will turn to Sandy Thurman. Given your long involvement with HIV policy from the US government, can you describe to us a little bit more about how PEPFAR first began partnering with faith organizations and how that has evolved?
Sure. Thank you, and thank you all for being here. You know, it's interesting, the faith community has been a partner in our response to HIV since the very beginning of the epidemic, both domestically and globally. And so I think that our partnership in PEPFAR was an outgrowth of our experience and partnerships with faith-based organizations on the domestic side for a number of years. When we really began looking at the disproportionate impact of the epidemic in Africa back in the late 1990s and early 2000, it was a lot of our interest and a lot of the pressure that was brought to bear on the U.S. government and policymakers was from faith-based organizations who were on the ground in Africa seeing the devastation that was occurring on the continent. So they've been a natural partner for us. Faith-based organizations and faith actors have been a natural partner with those of us working in the HIV and AIDS response from the beginning. And so when we began to expand the global program to focus on HIV internationally, and I want to sort of put this in perspective, when I was actually working in the White House, our global AIDS budget had been $125 million a year for 7 years in a row, which now was, of course, a rounding error in our PEPFAR program. So we saw when the interest, you know, sort of started, faith-based organizations were at the forefront of encouraging us to really respond in a very robust way. And that, of course, ultimately led to the development of PEPFAR. I just add, though, that our faith-based partnerships were not based on politics. They were based on pragmatism, that when we looked at the people who were on the ground, who had access, who had trust in the communities, all the things that we knew we needed in partners to move quickly in PEPFAR, they were a primary and natural partner for us.
It's so interesting how all this has evolved, and we'll get into more of some of the spectrum of groups and the challenges and opportunities that has presented. But that leads in perhaps for Mark to tell us a little bit more about your office at USAID.
Sure.
What are the goals? What is your outreach? What is your strategy?
Sure. So I have the great privilege to head this office at USAID that has its origins back around 2003 under the Bush administration and trying to do a more systemic and engagement with the faith community. That said, USAID has been working with faith groups since the inception of the agency 52 odd years ago. And so this wasn't in one way new to the agency. There was a new emphasis and a new way of looking at it and to reach out to a broader group of partners, I would say. And that continues to be a guiding star for the agency. But if you think about buckets of work, certainly to be the ombudsman into the agency, the Sherpa, to carry groups that want to work with USAID and don't know quite how to get in the door of the bureaucracy can come through us to do that. Groups to act a little bit like an ombudsman when there are problems, we can help facilitate finding solutions to problems for faith-based and community groups. We also try to do proactive outreach, so to convene. So around Ebola, as a recent example, you know, we organized with the White House and Department of State a conference call with faith-based actors across the United States. And that include, you know, we had 400 people on that call to talk about Ebola and what the role of the faith-based community might play. We did smaller groupings of that in DC as well. We're at 30 or 40 organizations. So there's a convening role of the organization. And there's a role of supporting the other parts of USAID that are trying to get things done. So we support the missions and their engagement. And that's a critical part of the ID. For a big, you know, government agency, we're very decentralized. Our missions in individual countries are vital, and really decision-making happens much there. And so those are all the ways that we try to put it in, and so we try to make our engagement with the faith community as robust as possible, especially when there's areas like health, in emergencies, when the faith-based community have unique things to bring to the table.
Thank you. One of the things that came up, in fact, on the last panel was how much of the share of the U.S. government support goes through faith-based organizations. And so many of us turn to Kaiser for that kind of analysis. And I wonder, Jen, if you could tell us a little bit more about how much Kaiser has approached that and why that's a complicated set of numbers to find.
Right, thanks, Janet. And you know, I just want to say that I want to commend the Lancet and the authors who put this issue together to start or really pick up and formalize an evidence-based framework, which is so critical, that I don't think has existed at this level ever for looking at the intersection of faith-based organizations and health. And so for this question, which is one that we always ask at Kaiser, what do we know? What's the scope of the involvement? And Mark and I were talking in advance of this, and clearly money is just one measure of this. There's many more ways to look at involvement, but money is one that we all care about and pay attention to. And so in preparation for, you know, thinking about that question, I will share some data that we just looked at. But there's also some really good work that's being done now on this. IHME and the researchers at and Chris Murray's shop, I think with Gene Duff, looked recently at development assistance for health. And there's an article that just came out a couple weeks ago on this, roughly estimating that over the last decade or more, about 30% of all development assistance for health has been channeled through faith-based organizations. And that's a complex analysis. There's a lot there, but I encourage people to look at that article. It was in PLUS Mag Journal, so that's available online. The other piece of work that's been done is Jane's work looking specifically at the share of revenues that faith-based organizations have that are from US government sources, and she actually found it was about 13%. So it's, I think, less than people think in their minds. So in preparation for this panel, I took a look at some data we recently released around non-governmental organizations. Another broad area that faith-based groups fit into that we don't know enough about. So what's the role of NGOs in US government global health? We put out a couple reports on this. We're putting out a summary analysis soon. So what we tried to do is say, well, what do we know about faith-based organizations within that framework? And what we looked at was 2013 data. That's 2014, just is available now. But 2013 data, disbursements by USAID. So there's all kinds of, you know, caveats there. But looking just at that year, when we were able to identify that faith-based organizations represented about 15% of NGOs that received a disbursement on global health from USAID in 2013. So 15% of the NGOs were faith-based. And just about 4% of the funding went to them. So again, I think it's less than people think. And it would be good to look at a historical analysis and see maybe how that has changed. We also found that faith-based organizations within the NGO community were more likely to be working in Africa than NGOs overall. Not a surprise probably to those of us here, but an important data point. And the area that they were most likely to be working in, again, not a surprise, HIV. Malaria was also a big one. And malaria and HIV probably more so than NGOs overall, less so in family planning. So those were some of the findings that we looked at. We'd like to look more in depth, but just to give you a sense, so more likely to be in Africa, HIV and malaria were two big areas, and probably less funding than people think. I will just to give you the funding amount, because I think I can see people wondering what that amount is. It was about $96 million in 2013. To give you a sense. That's less, actually, than the Global Fund amount identified in the IHME analysis. So.
Thank you. We're just going to run through a series of questions and then come back and give you a chance to interact with each other. Perhaps linked to this, the question of who are these, what are these organizations, where are they working, what are they working on? Sandy, you've described from your long years of work the spectrum of kinds of organizations, which helps underscore the opportunities and the challenges of working with them. Perhaps you could talk a little bit more about what you mean when you talk about different approaches needed for different kinds of faith-based organizations.
Sure, and thank you. I think this is this is a genesis of some of the challenges we've had around building these partnerships between faith-based organizations and governments. It's because it's hard to if we say faith-based organizations, that means a lot of things. Faith-based organizations can range from anything from the Catholic health system in the United States of America, which I think is still, and I'm just using the U.S. as an example, is still the second largest healthcare system in the country, to very small, clinics or NGOs or orphans and vulnerable children's programs on the ground. So there's this incredible broad range. Very big differences in capacity, very big differences in ability to deliver services. And so I think our challenge, our challenge to both donors and to faith-based organizations is to begin to define with greater specificity and communicate what those differences are for people. And it certainly came up a lot in the meeting that was held at the bank this week and has before. And I think when we look at revamping our mechanisms in order to be more effective, build more effective partnerships, we've got to be able to name those things so that when we have partnerships and define roles and responsibilities and establish monitoring and evaluation and accountability mechanisms and so forth, that we have to just be very clear about what we're dealing with and that it could be very big or very small. But what you don't want to lose in that is that we know from all of our years in public health that if we want to really look at sustainable change at the end of the day, we want to be able to have countries take full responsibility and ownership of the work that's being done in their countries, that has to be rooted on the ground in grassroots organizations all over the country. So if we want to sustain the impact that we've had in PEPFAR, or we want to look at sustainable development, we've got to figure this out. So we need to just stay at it until we do. And it won't be easy. It's like, it's like family dynamics. I mean, they're not easy, but it doesn't mean you abandon the family. I mean, you stay in there and you work at it. And I think that's sort of where we are in this conversation. It's very exciting.
Well, it's interesting because one of the pieces of sustainability, which is, of course, a big theme here in Washington and everywhere, is also the link to the private sector and the longer-term financing issues that link to sustainability. And Mark, you have talked about the added financial value of working with faith-based organizations and the outreach. Can you describe a little bit more about your outreach to faith-based groups as a link to the private sector?
Sure. So I think there's two elements of this. One is that faith-based organizations, like most non-governmental organizations, have robust fundraising largely from the private sector and have partnerships via their boards and other mechanisms in which they've been engaging the private sector since they existed. They've had to do that. The other is a more directive to say, as we're looking more at the importance of the private sector in development generally, healthcare in particular, what are the ways we can think about the faith community, those business people who are motivated by their faith, but will never put a religious icon on what they do? So, for example, there's a project that we're working on at USAID, about to be finalized, on health, a small health experiment in a way to see if business principles can provide some sustainability and provision of health care, clean water, and others in the Eastern Democratic Republic of Congo. And a consortium of business leaders that are connected to the National Christian Foundation in the United States have put up $1 million of that partnership that we're working together. And the National Christian Foundation, the philanthropy that flows through every year is hundreds of millions of dollars. A lot of that, a good significant part of that will go to international activities. How can we haven't formalized partnerships with that kind of flow and that kind of access to capital, as well as the expertise that's within that community to bring it to bear. And I think that's really fertile ground to build on.
Jen, you've done a lot of work over the years on the U.S. response to the AIDS epidemic, of course. And there's, as we've discussed in the first panel and in the Lancet
piece, we saw the importance of some of the faith-based organizations' role in that response, as well as the Ebola response that was touched on also in the first panel. Do you want to reflect a little bit more on your view of how that has had an impact in U.S. response?
Sure. To pick up on something Sandy said about the role of faith-based organizations and the faith community in HIV from day one, I mean, that's clear in the U.S. domestic case as well as globally. But I also, you know, I think it's really important to note that from the case study perspective of PEPFAR, you know, how did PEPFAR come to be? When we all look back and try to put together, you know, what were the elements that went into many of us, you know, watching that State of the Union speech and hearing $15 billion and wondering how we were able to get there, it's clear that without the faith community, that would not have happened. So the faith community was, from the case study perspective of PEPFAR, an essential element to making PEPFAR happen. So it's not just on the ground delivering services and being partners, but really pushing the U.S. government to go to another level. So I think that's just really important to, from my perspective, looking at it from the long term. And I think on the Ebola response, it's pretty clear that without engaging the faith community the way governments had to do, realizing they had to, or we would not have been able to turn around that crisis. And hopefully, the lessons from that experience will be evident and ready, you know, to pull not just back on a shelf, but the next time a crisis like this occurs, whether it's Ebola again or something else, it's for, you know, at the forefront of this, approaching communities with cultural understanding, with the engaging the leaders in those communities that understand them and can speak to them, is the only way we can really get ahead of this. So I'll leave it at that.
It's quite clear there's been huge impact and benefit, and also very big challenges that have been presented by the engagement, particularly from the PEPFAR perspective. Sandy, could you talk to us a little bit about some of the hardest parts of PEPFAR's history in dealing with the faith community, and what lessons have been learned, and how has that impacted the current PEPFAR strategy?
Sure. I think that, and again, it was not new with PEPFAR. We've had, you know, challenges in HIV and AIDS with the faith-based community, and, you know, challenges and incredible opportunities from the beginning. But it was certainly true in PEPFAR. I think that, you know, we've had to, well, a couple of things. I think it's been very, very hard for a mechanism as big as PEPFAR to find the way to operationalize our partnerships with faith-based organizations on the ground. And so that's been one. And then we've had, you know, stumbles around and challenges around issues of reproductive health, certainly around the LGBT community. We've seen, you know, a lot of those play out in recent days. I think where we hang on this, interestingly, is more in places like Washington, D.C., and in our big institutions rather than on the ground. What I have found always so inspiring is that the way that people who are actually on the ground doing this work figure out a way to work together. And oftentimes that we at headquarters and in policymaking bodies just make everybody's, I mean, as we try to make it better, but sometimes I think we make it worse. Because people are so, you know, people are creative, especially people who are working on the ground and very hard to serve, it's hard to serve populations in the far reaching places in the world. You know, people figure this out. I think this is a place where we need to learn from colleagues on the ground and bring those lessons learned up to the top. That's something that Dr. Blevins mentioned. I think we also have to be really careful then in wanting to be so politically correct in our the way we engage as policymakers that we don't put people at risk. So we want to tell the story about the, you know, nuns who are buying office supplies for an NGO that's secular so that they can trade and get condoms and won't get caught by the bishop, you know, in the old days. I mean, we had all these wonderful stories about people just figuring it out on their own. I think we need to take lessons from our colleagues on the ground. It continues to be a challenge for us. But the other thing that we talked a lot about is that finding common ground. And again, when we define with real specificity what our roles and responsibilities are when we engage in a partnership, it's almost like a I don't know why I'm using all these marriage metaphors today, but you know, it's like a prenup. So we, you know, have a prenuptial agreement. We know that this is what we're bringing, and this is where we don't go, and you can't touch this, and I'm not going to touch, you know, all that. And we have to just define with greater specificity how we engage, and I also think it takes some mystery out of this. If you've got, you know, secular institutions and faith-based institutions, if you really dig down and up front and define with greater specificity, you can find that common ground and not put each other at risk in any way.
And to be more specific, we have some real controversies that have emerged, particularly most recently in Uganda.
Yes.
And I'd like to hear a little bit more from Mark about that episode, putting the LGBT community at such risk, the funding for the Interreligious Council being withdrawn by the U.S. because of that. What lessons were learned from that, and what new practices or vetting procedures or new mechanisms arose from that?
Maybe I should summarize first, you know, just quickly. Legislators within Uganda proposed an anti-homosexuality act that was draconian at best in terms of its treatment of LGBT people. The discrimination of them, the description of them and their own, who they were as people, was in so many ways beyond the pale. The Interreligious Council and members of the Interreligious Council campaigned positively for that legislation and vocally took out ads in the paper, spoke at a huge rally. I was in Uganda when that rally went on, and you're listening to this and thinking that this is just such a horrible situation. And essentially what happened, I think the U.S. government lost confidence in the Interreligious Council being able to carry out their mandate and serve people without bias, because of it was so beyond the pale of what we normally saw in terms of active campaigning, the public's nature among all the Interreligious Council members. There were nuances between them, but largely all were for it. So funding was withdrawn from that institution, and mechanisms were put in place to still meet the need of people in Uganda so that they weren't left without treatment. In terms of lessons learned, I think, you know, that situation has become polarized. I come out of a community organizing background. When you polarize, you have to figure out how to depolarize. I don't know that we've done that successfully yet. How do we depolarize? The other thing I think we need to do in a lesson learned is, how do we learn more about what the actual discrimination is on the ground? So we have the evidence that says, yes, this rhetoric links to a set of behaviors that are happening that are impacting people negatively. We don't know that right now. We make some assumptions that are reasonable, but in other cases, there have been religious leaders at the top saying some bad things, but the providers on the ground continuing to do good work. So we need to figure that out. There was a study that USAID did in relation to PEPFAR in Jamaica about bias. I think that's a model for what we want to do in other places and replicate that to see what the real actions are on the ground. What are people experiencing? What are they perceived to be experiencing? What can we also witness to be experiencing?
Certainly another area of challenge involves family planning and reproductive health. And Jen, I wonder if you wanted to talk a little bit about what you've seen in terms of how that has played out.
Yeah, I actually want to just say one thing, pick up where Mark left off around LGBT rights and the issues that happen. There is a really good new study that came out looking at Nigeria and the perceptions of gay men on the ground and their ability to get services and what they need, and finding a link actually between the rhetoric and their own fears about seeking services. So that, but I agree, getting that evidence and summarizing it in a way that policymakers and program managers can understand is what really very, very critical. And something that goes to the family planning issue, that actually I want to paraphrase something that Ambassador Burke said. I think the overriding, you know, sort of issue here for policymakers is really about public health. So it's really the public health approach. What works for public health? And as she said much more eloquently than I'm going to paraphrase, that stigma in any form, discrimination in any form, is not what public health and human rights is about and cannot help us be most effective in our response to HIV. And that plays out in the family planning discussion. But you know, stepping back, I think that the polarization around family planning is very clear in Washington. And I think what happens is that people don't realize or make assumptions that faith-based communities are not champions of family planning, when many, many are. in fact, leading on providing family planning services on the ground. I think that's the evidence for that is there. So there's a sort of mischaracterization often of the community, and it's a very diverse community, so that also doesn't work as a characterization. I think where the challenges arise is that when there are effective services, such as modern contraception being most effective in terms of what women who want family planning methods should get, according to public health evidence, and if there are faith-based organizations or other organizations who can't provide that effective service or won't, it's really incumbent upon the USG to figure, to look and do an assessment and say, well, how do we reach those who need the services the most? What's the best way to do that? And I think that's really where the emphasis needs to be. From a public health perspective and meeting the goals, how do we reach those who need services most and put that together from a government perspective?
I know we're going to have a lot of questions from the audience, but I wonder, Sandy, if you could just talk to us for a minute about how does all this fit into PEPFAR 3.0?
Well, I think it fits just squarely into PEPFAR 3.0. And we know that we're going to have to, going forward, take a very strong public health approach to containing and eliminating the epidemic in ways that, not that we didn't do before, but now that we have limited resources, we have more people on treatment, we've got to continue to move forward, and we're really going to have to focus more and more as time goes on. So that's very important. Our best partners, or some of our best partners in doing that work, are again going to be our faith-based partners, because we've got to get into communities. We've got to develop those access those relationships of trust to get people into treatment, to keep them on treatment. All the things that we know that we have to do that it often takes time to do, develop relationships and getting in communities and identifying people who need to be in services and getting them into treatment and keeping them in treatment. We can't do that on our own. So we've got to find the partners who are already in community to help us do that. So expanding our partnerships with faith-based organizations is a critical part of that. And again, it comes down to, it's very pragmatic from a public health perspective. We've got to identify folks, we've got to get them in treatment, we've got to keep them in treatment. And those programs have to be rooted in communities and on the ground. Otherwise, there's not sustainability in our work. So they're a primary partner and a big piece of our work going forward.
And Mark, you talked about exactly that issue, the sort of cultural literacy, I think you called it, training for U.S. government agencies to work better with FBOs to be able, if we're allowed to use the term for now, including new training for how to work with religious groups. Can you just say a word about what that entails?
Sure. So general frame is that the various agencies of the U.S. government have came together over the past few years, and there is an interagency now strategy on global religious leader and faith community engagement. Part of that strategy calls for more training within our agencies across government on how to work with faith-based organizations. At USAID, we've received money from our human capital team and talent management team, basically our HR department, to begin to do that within USAID, to formalize new training processes using modern pedagogy and distance learning for our missions and things. And so that's really going on for us very strongly. So I have a member of my team who's worked with many of you, Pamela Lyville Staples, who's leading that effort to do more training and sensitivity. I would say, though, there's also the other side of that coin is, how do the faith-based organizations provide the literacy training towards working with government 101 and 201 and 301, which is, as we all know, a challenge of itself.
Thank you all. I have lots of questions, but I think you all do too. So let's open it up. Again, we'll take about three at a time. Please identify yourself and your brief question. And then we'll do another round after that. So please wait for the mic so that our online viewers can hear you as well. So first question.
Hi, thank you. I'm John Blevins from Emory University. Jonathan Mann put forth the perspective that human rights has to ground the moral vision and the work of a lot of what we're talking about here. And that has been an important concept and an important kind of grounding for a lot of our work.
But in our work, at least in Kenya, with faith-based organizations that work with men who have sex with men, work in LGBT communities, work with sex workers, work with people who use drugs, they almost never reference the term. And they actually have talked with us, and a lot of us know this, that in around contentious issues, the term and invoking human rights immediately becomes this, has an effect of being seen as the West trying to impose cultural values on another part of the world. But our faith-based partners invoke their own religious traditions and religious teachings to do similar kind of work. One of the things I found really powerful at the World Bank meeting is Dr. Kim invoked a preferential option for the poor, a perspective out of liberation theology and Roman Catholicism. It feels to me that around finding a kind of common moral space on contentious issues, that there are intersections that we haven't explored very much. And I know that faith-based leaders are working to do that in some ways in various parts of the world. I wonder if you all have any thoughts as to how we might understand those kind of common moral grounds that give us new language beyond just the language of human rights, not abandoning it, but expanding it.
Denise Leonard, Open House Systems. How much, when a USAID or somebody funds these programs, are they also attaching to it the sufficient funds to then do the evidence-based analysis of the intervention as well? And are they making that? I mean, it seems to me like in the first part we were talking about evidence-based interventions and faith-based, and I mean, obviously funding for that kind of analysis is also important, and how much is that attached in the packages?
One more question for this round? All right, let's turn back to the panel. We have two very interesting questions. One, first, let's take the human rights question and the going beyond extending, including human rights, but going beyond that term. Sandy, do you want to start off?
Sure. I think that, you know, again, you know, there's been some really interesting work done over, you know, on this around better language and better words and, defining the way that we, talk to each other about these kinds of issues. But it's limited. And I think coming out of the conference, and we've had a lot of dialogue about this, but coming out of the conference yesterday, I think it's clear that we need to spend some time looking at expanded kinds of language that works for everyone and that's not polarizing in and of itself. I mean, and we all, respect, and I'm sure Jonathan Mann, who was just an extraordinary visionary in our field, but understanding that we have to, our language has to change as time changes. We can't, we have to keep moving on and finding common language as more partners come to the table. I think it's something that we need to invest in, and we really haven't, a conversation that I'd love to have with colleagues going forward for us in PEPFAR, and I know for others, because again, if these partnerships are going to work like we need them to work, then we have to invest in figuring out what the, what the foundation of that looks like, and then, to come to some agreement on that.
Jen, maybe you want to come in on this issue of universality of human rights, right, and the impact of language here.
Right. Language is critical. I mean, if you don't speak the same language as somebody, you have to work on an understanding. So how people speak about a situation or a group is clearly, there's been a lot of work done on that. I completely agree that figuring out the right way to frame these discussions with different communities is we have not done a good job of it. I do wonder, though, about the human rights, using that language, because when the Uganda and Nigeria situations were at their height, I was involved in a lot of conversations with people in DC as well as in Africa about language and how to approach it and how to make the case that these were harmful laws. And there was one of the discussions that kept coming up was LGBT rights or human rights. And human rights, some said you have to really focus on human rights, and that's what's going to speak to a whole sector of societies that society that will not necessarily be part of an LGBT rights discussion. So I don't think it's clear. It depends on communities, and obviously there are religious leaders where human rights language is also the language they use. So, but to your point, we have not cracked this nut at all. So,
can I say on this, a resource that I don't think we at USAID have used enough or a place to turn is our foreign service nationals, which are the people from the countries in which we're working who will work for USAID at a long period of time, decades often. And they are rooted in their own communities. They're often from the religious traditions we're talking about. And they often have the set of relationships, certainly for longevity, when foreign services officers rotate after a fairly short number of years. So I've come to appreciate in my 3 years the role and how do we figure out how to better use our and work with our foreign service nationals to address these questions of language, perspective, and relationships.
Mark, maybe you also want to take the first crack at the question about funding for the evidence.
So I think that where you get into now is the difference between evidence and evaluation. And certainly we're there on evaluation. That's built into our requirements of our funding. We don't tend to fund a lot of evidence. And that's a gap. And to be honest, I don't know where we're going to solve that. We talk to, our budgets are largely dictated by Capitol Hill. And so maybe it's a conversation there as well. But you know, we're good on evaluation. We're not so good on evidence.
Sandy? I think this is it really is a place where we as government donors are slightly schizophrenic because we keep asking for evidence and demanding evidence and talking about data, and then we box ourselves into only having the monitoring and evaluation that Mark talks about. I think that's a conversation we really need to have, and it's not an easy one because, again, we're all funded by the U.S. Congress, and we have our own sort of challenges around that. It's also a place where I think that advocacy on the part of our faith-based partners could be very helpful for us, to say that, we have all this anecdotal data, but, we're hamstrung by the fact that you're asking for evidence that we can't pay to get. And see if we can't be a little more creative in these conversations with our colleagues down the street to see if we can't find a way to do that. Or external partners, that appreciate the need for evidence, foundations and other donors who might not be as restricted as we are.
I neglected to give, I think, a positive story, though. USAID has funded the Institute for Reproductive Health at Georgetown millions of dollars to look at the efficacy of fertility beads for family planning purposes. And there has been evidence now that those do work, they are efficacious. And so we can fund those as a tool to use to reach our goals in family planning. Obviously, we're gonna have a whole lot of other tools. But that particular tool is acceptable by many religious groups that are opposed to the other tools. And so I think that is one positive story that we might look at replicating.
Do we have other questions from the audience? Right here in the middle.
Hi, my name is Jenna Karp. I'm here from the State Department. And it's come up a couple times in terms of the Ebola crisis in West Africa, but I was wondering if you could speak more generally about the role that faith-based groups could play in pandemic preparedness and response and sort of lessons learned from Ebola in the past year or 2 years.
Other questions?
Good morning again, and my name is Rosemary. Can I just go back to the collaboration? How do we collaborate with the USAID, with PEFA? I want to thank PEFA. I met President Bush before he left office in the Faith-Based Initiative 2008, and we talked about the same. How do we come up with this collaboration of outreach, advocacy in the rural areas, so there on in Africa, and as she said, lessons learned on Ebola, because there was no mechanism of outreach, advocacy, and education to people. So local people, CPOs, play so much do so much work on the ground, but nobody gives them a credit and nobody funds them. So we should look at the CPOs and the local faith-based organization in the rural areas. The big judges don't work with, want to work with the small organization, and the small organizations are the ones who do a lot. So USID, PEFA, and, you know, look into that and follow up, up to the ground, because we do a lot of work, and how do we collaborate again? Thank you.
There are no other questions. We'll turn to the panel for these two. Again, the question of the role of the faith groups in pandemic preparedness.
I think that it's, well, the engaging faith-based organizations in emergency preparedness and pandemic preparedness is critical. Again, we've done that domestically, and as we look at system strengthening, it's a little bit more difficult for us to do it on a global, with global reach as it is to do, than it is to do at home with domestic reach. But certainly faith-based organizations and other private actors have to be partners. And in any kind of emergency preparedness or pandemic preparedness. And I think people are very aware of that, certainly in the aftermath of the Ebola epidemic. And, you know, the faith-based organizations were on the ground responding to the epidemic before anybody else could figure out what to do. One of the things I think that's come up in our conversations around emergency preparedness is also training our first responders on how to engage with people who are already doing the work on the ground when they arrive. And so that the transfer of and the partnership and the integration of already on the ground indigenous services is done in a way that honors the people who are responding first and engages the people who are our first responders coming from big organizations and multilaterals and donors and others. So we have a lot to learn, but there's no doubt, I think from CDC's perspective or others, that faith-based partners have to be a big part of that process.
Do you want to come in?
Yeah, I totally agree. The preparedness side of the equation, which has always been harder for policymakers to focus on, the response to crises is much easier. So that's a whole other event to discuss. But just what will be important is to look at going forward, to what extent are faith organizations and leaders involved in preparedness now, because there's been so much more attention to the need to have better preparedness because of Ebola. And there's new money available for that. I will say in 2013, I was just looking back, there is a funding line that USAID has to look at emerging threats and preparedness, essentially. Very few NGOs get money in that regard, and there's reasons for that. No faith-based organizations got disbursements for that in 2013. This is pre-Ebola. So it'll be important to look at that going forward, I think.
One story on small, that you're thinking whether you work with small groups or not. And former Administrator Shaw, when he went to Liberia, met with a small orphanage and school that had been, had to basically shut down and needed food to feed many of their students. And so this was a very small operation, and there was some, do we really want to go there? It also turned out that the pastor that ran this had a national radio show that covered the country. So what at first glance was small became very big, because he was able to send messages out and was very widely respected. So I think we have to be open to being surprised by and being careful when we think something's small, because it may not be so small, actually, and the influence that can go out. I also think we are, in terms of, the second phase of Ebola response, and, we want to build back better. USAID is in conversation with the international part of the Catholic Health Association and seeing if there's a way we can partner on health system strengthening about Ebola, about ending child and preventable, maternal preventable deaths. I think that's also a key to try to reach some of these organizations. Sandy mentioned Catholic Health in terms of doing health system strengthening across the board with faith and non-faith organizations together to build in the resiliency to take these shocks and respond appropriately and not get set back so far.
Any thoughts on the collaboration piece? We've talked a lot about that up to now, but any additional thoughts on collaborating with community-based organizations? That last question.
I think, again, that we have to continue to expand our capacity. And that really has to be done. You know, big governments will never have the capacity to directly fund very small organizations. It's just not, I mean, we don't have the bandwidth to be able to do that, as much as we would like to, because we recognize that's often where we get the best return on our investment. But we'll continue to rely on robust coordinating mechanisms and organizations that comprise many different faith-based groups so that we can get the money to the ground. I think that's certainly the way that USAID does their funding, and I think it's the best of what we've got at the moment. I think there's always room for improvement, and again, part of what we're talking about going forward is how do we improve these mechanisms and increase our capacity to get closer to the ground.
I think just in these last couple of minutes that we have, I'd love to give you all a chance for some final comments, but also ask you to reflect on precisely that. What are the next steps, including to address some of the hard issues? I mean, the paper in The Lancet that talked about the challenges, about child marriage, about gender-based violence, about gender, about family planning and reproductive health. There are some very big issues that the U.S. government is focused on in its own strategies. And sometimes the faith community can help in those strategies, and at times they are a barrier to implementing U.S. goals in that area. So when you're thinking about next steps, please include how to address these big challenges. Jen, do you want to start us off?
Sure. I think this echoes what a lot of the authors said, and then others have said in the audience and the panel, but looking at the next sort of phase of U.S. global health policy and global health more generally and SDGs with a better at least articulation that we have to reach the poorest of the poor, that if we can't have the world we want if we don't. Faith-based organizations and religious communities have always done that in a way that other groups haven't always been able to. And so I think we can't reach those goals without their integral involvement. I think that's been pretty clear, and the evidence in the paper shows that. So that's one. Two, I think, are on the challenges. We have to name them, and the article does that. I think naming them and talking about them and trying to understand where there's common ground, where there's difficulties, and figuring out, ultimately with a goal of getting services to people who need them, from public health, evidence-based services to people who need them is the end game that we want. And then lastly, data. I mean, we need it. We just took a cursory look for today, but I'd like to do more on that. I think Kaiser, but all of us who can should, and I think that's really critical.
Mark?
Where you live often shapes where you think. So where I'm located within USAID, I don't see the negatives as much as the positives, because we're flooded with great opportunities in how to engage, right? We get frustrated sometimes, we can't take all of them, but to be honest, we're to see the partnerships that are going on are just really terrific, and so I'm very positive and high on this. I think in terms of addressing the challenges, it is the faith communities can be the tripwires for the challenge and the solution at the same time to the challenges. So on gender-based violence, for example, we've had conversations with the chair of the North American Council of Somalia Moms. And he's very interested in working with us on addressing gender-based violence in Somalia, taking the networks that the imams here maintain in Somalia and in the communities of Somalis in Kenya and Ethiopia and other places. And so he's already reached out to the head imam in Somalia to say, will you work with me on this? And there's an agreement there. We're not working out how to make that happen. There's some private foundations that want to come together. We want to look at that. The imam came to meet with us at USAID a couple weeks ago. I'm going to go out to Minneapolis to speak with him directly. So I think we can take the mechanisms we have for public-private partnerships, work with faith-based groups and other folks, and use the religious leaders to answer the challenges that may come out of the religious community.
I just want to agree with what the other panelists have said and just add a couple of things. One is that we certainly need to reach the poorest of the poor, but I want us to not leave the very marginalized for other reasons behind, and which makes it a much more difficult conversation for us, but is absolutely necessary, certainly in HIV and AIDS, but other issues as well. The other is to focus on the importance of literacy and cross-training of public health practitioners and faith faith-based practitioners. And this, you know, there, we've had some great pioneers like Jonathan Mann, like Bill Fagey, that's sort of an icon for some of us in public health, Jimmy Carter, and others who recognized the importance of this 30 years ago and started work on this. So, you know, there is a very robust but small body of work on cross-training our practitioners and people on the ground to talk with each other and define some of that common language that John was talking about. So that helps us have, you know, we have to have the same language to have a conversation about particularly sensitive issues. It's always always a challenge. But just to end on something that, a trend that I see in academia and elsewhere that I think speaks to the future in a very important way, and that's this incredible growth that we have seen on faculty with John at Emory, that we have seen in interdisciplinary approaches to development, to public health, and to theology that include all of our schools, also a real growth in dual degree programs in theology and public health and development and theology, and all of this cross-training that I think makes me very hopeful about what the leadership will look like, you know, 10 years from now and 15 years from now on these kinds of issues that we all hold so dear. So I think there's a lot of bright light on the horizon when it comes to new leadership.
Well, I think this has been such an interesting panel, and I think it opens the door for, as the first panel said, so many more conversations, so much more happening in the field right now. And great thanks to all of you for the work you're all doing in this area and for sharing your insights with us, because I think this has been very, very enlightening. So please join me in thanking our panel.
Thank you. Thank you.